Sing, oh, sing of the sun-muscled manticore. Thundering fleet are their scarlet feet, and great are their echoing roars. No hunter more patient than we, no serpent so sour-tailed as we, no snarling leaps lighter, no long teeth are brighter than ours on the scrub-spotted deserts of home. Let us have none of that. Do not sing of us. We do not want your songs. We will sing, and you will listen. The desert is wide and white, and dry as an old bone. We worry it, we gnaw and tear and peel it bald. And we sing when the moon is jumping on the sand like a skinny white mouse. We sing, and the salt bush weeps. The oases ripple under our breath. The blue and clear water where the rhinoceros wrangle, where the cheetah purrs and licks her paws, and the upas trees waver green and violet in the scalding breeze. They will tell you the upas is a death power. They will call it the hydra tree of the desert, and warn that if you sleep beneath it for even a night, you may wake, but to no morning man has known. They will say that 300 soldiers, all in bronze and feathers, camped beneath an upas once, to drink from the clear stream that flowed beneath its branches, and that by the time the sun touched their toes, all were dead and cold as dinner. This is ridiculous, a fairy tale. But I suppose it is yet not entirely untrue, for the upas is our mother, and we are enough of death for anyone. And if soldiers camp under an upas when she is blowing her seed, it is no fault of the hungry kittens that tumble out if they find their supper plump and laid out on the sand. Look, passers-by, though not too closely, at the radiant upas, lover of the sun, in their golden bedchamber. Her red branches thick and strong as a haunch, thorny and pitted, her green needles far too glossy and stiff to grow in the thirsty desert. Look at her fruit, nestled in the shadowy forks of her knotted trunk, how scarlet and purple, how thick and full of juice. Touch one at your peril, for these gleaming berries are not fruit, but eggs, and it is we that grow within them, in the crimson sacks which wax in the blistering scrub light, full of the peculiar upas yolk we drink and drink, which fills our tails with enough poison for a lifetime, until we rip that silk-thin skin and tumble out headfirst into the water, or soldiers, whichever seems most convenient. In the fruit sack we know all things, how the sun preened on the face of the oasis pool, how one upas, though neither the tallest or most beautiful thing in the desert, opened up her branches and grasped the reddening beams for her own. Her wood warmed and the pool rippled. The sun would not have noticed if his mirror had not been marred. He would have been angry and scorched the tree for her theft, had not the first manticore fruit burst open before him, and if he did not think the little cub with her needled teeth and her whipping tail and her sky-bright eyes was the most lovely of all imaginable things, and immediately set about to teaching her to sting and roar and sing and kill all the things he knew. The upas smiled and told her sisters how to follow her lead. After we fall, it is harder to remember these things, to know they are true. But we do our best to love our parents and turn our prayers to the sky and the sand. It is only unfortunate that we are more or less helpless when the upas blows us free, no more fierce than little red kittens or infant snakes, blind and wet and mewling. Our tails do thrash quick and sharp in those first hours, indiscriminate, for we have not quite learned to control them when the oasis, littered with palm nuts and antelope ribs, catches us in green-gold arms. This is when the wranglers come, if they are clever, with their silver tail caps spangling in the desert light. I would like to tell you I was reared in the open flats, the white and worried bone, that I tore open leopards and antelope and rhinoceros. I would like to tell you that the sun and I ran together, bounding red-pawed over the salt bush and the pale weeds, that in the warm red rocks I rolled with my legs in the air, scratching and roaring and eating as I pleased. I would like to tell you that the echoes there taught me to sing. I would like to tell you I was happy and that the sun was high in the sky. But the wranglers came, with a little silver cap, something like a thimble with buckles and straps, and armored in polished metals, splashed with the last desperate strikes of countless kittens, lashed the thing to my barbed tail. My thrashings were dull thuds and sprays of sand, but nothing more. I howled. It is not only the province of wolves. I howled, and that did startle them, for the voice of the manticore is terrible and piercing and sweet, the sweetest and most terrible of all possible voices, like a flute and a trumpet playing together. It is barbed as surely as a tail. I howled and keened, thumping my useless limb against the ground pitifully. They took out wax stoppers and closed their ears to me, and into an amber cage I went, clapped in an amber collar and gagged in leather to keep me silent. Tell me again how the gazelli sing. Tell me that no melodies are lovelier than theirs. The amber cage had an amber lock, and the girl had an amber key. She kept it on the beads that slung around her like chains, dangling right at the base of her throat. In those days, any number of creatures were brought from every hovel and height in the land to delight this creature, whose clear, calm eyes took in everything with equal regard and due. She was dutifully amazed at my fur and my tail, dutifully frightened at my muffled roar, dutifully patted my head, and dutifully passed on to the next wonder of nature brought up the trees for her pleasure. She took no joy in any one animal over any other, and her voice was genteel and grateful when she thanked the wranglers for bringing her these miracles and grotesqueries. By the latter she meant me, and thus I was given my name. For some weeks she came, dutifully, to visit her menagerie, escorted by wranglers and noble nursemaids and occasionally her father. Their games were odd and solemn. She sang to the animals and sat them to tea with amber cups they could not help but break, and scolded them for their manners. She forced their struggling heads onto her breast, and all exclaimed it a miracle that her gentleness of spirit and purity of heart could charm the most savage of monsters. She did not charm me. After attempting to get me to drink from her dainty cups and sing with her while she did her sewing, she declared with great sadness that the beast she had named in jest was truly a grotesque beyond salvation, and that I should be sent away, for I was surely in my unfathomable heart unhappy there. I knew this meant the slaughterhouse, or simply being shoved off the platforms into the narrow spit of sea. But what maiden knows the world is skewed to spare any testing of her virtue? When she and her escort had gone, a small dark shape remained, silhouetted against the door frame of the wretched zoo. It came into the light, and I saw that it was a girl like the other one and lost interest, save that she came and knelt by my cage, and loosing a strand of black beads from her throat, put her own amber key into the lock and opened the amber door.